Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Beverly Hills Confidential, A Century of Stars, Scandals, and Murders by Barbara Schroeder and Clark Fogg. Narrated by Rich Miller. Introduction. We met because of a murder, but not just any murder. It was the cold-blooded execution of a highly respected publicist gunned down on Sunset Boulevard in the heart of Beverly Hills. Our first meeting began with the classic reporter-investigator exchange. May I see that file? No. We were both familiar with this dance. Me, the nosy investigative reporter, and Clark Fogg, senior forensic specialist for the Beverly Hills Police Department, a gatekeeper of secrets at one of the most storied police departments in the world. Oh, the tales he could tell. I was trying to find out what really happened the night Hollywood publicity agent Ronnie Chasen was murdered. The police department said the classy blonde's execution was simply a random robbery gone bad. The killer was a transient on a bike looking to rob someone. Case closed. Legions of doubters, myself included, were suspicious. After all, it seemed odd that the gunman was on a bike. Plus, a report claimed bullets from the killer's gun didn't match those found in the dead woman's body. The white vinyl Chasen murder book was right on top of Fogg's file cabinet, just out of my reach. I reminded him that our paths had crossed on numerous headline-grabbing cases, like the Menendez murders, the sexcapades of Madame Heidi Fleiss, and the Winona Ryder shoplifting saga. But no matter how I tried to establish a rapport, Fogg would not let me see that Chasen file. There would be no exclusives at this time. I got up to leave when another murder book caught my eye, the Greystone Mansion killings from way back in 1929. This was the city's first blockbuster crime. A filthy rich father builds his son the biggest mansion in Beverly Hills, and just a few months later, the son is found dead there, lying near his equally dead male secretary. Was it a case of a clandestine gay love affair gone bad, or an anger-fueled bloodbath over a political scandal? The answer, a holy grail in Beverly Hills crime reporting, could be inside that file. May I look at that? I asked, my calm demeanor belying my pounding heart. Maybe, he said. Depends on what you want it for. But first, take a look at this. I was intrigued. He unlocked a door marked private. Inside was a treasure trove, archives containing a century's worth of evidence and details of the dark underbelly of glamorous Beverly Hills. I pulled out some yellowed and brittle newspaper articles from a file marked old. They were sensational stories, now long forgotten, like the one about the pretty 25-year-old maid who hacked her boss to death after an argument over how to cut a roast, or the story of the nymphomaniac wife who hides teenage lover in attic, or yet another story of a female police pilot who was sunbathing nude, mid-air, on her plane's wing and crashed. The stories became even more intriguing. A cult in the 1930s invades a Beverly Hills mansion. An actress known as the Mexican Spitfire kills herself and her unborn child. And buried in the Bugsy Siegel mobster murder file, a new clue about the never-solved whodunit. Next, Clark showed me never-before-released evidence from the 1950s slaying of playboy Johnny Stompanato. Did his lover, the famous actress Lana Turner, twist the knife into his gut? Or was it her 14-year-old daughter? I saw heartbreaking photos of the mysterious death of the mother of radio talk show host Dr. Laura. Mom was mummified, dead for months, the details cringe-inducing. There were files bulging with never-published crime scene photos and police reports of recent cases that slipped by the media, like the one where a beautiful model murders her sugar daddy husband while he's trying to crawl away from her relentless barrage of bullets. But most chilling of all, we found a negative tucked inside an unmarked folder, no information attached. Holding it up to the bright lights in the CSI lab, we looked at the image, It was a showstopper. A young blonde, clutching a Kleenex, was laying face down, nude on a gurney. Covers were pulled back to reveal the chilling words, "Last Warning," scrawled backwards on her back. Did someone carve the letters into her skin? Who was she? It would take the combined efforts of Fogg's CSI expertise and our persistent research to find the answer. Our partnership had begun, a collaboration that's turned into this chronicle of an unprecedented century of crazy crimes, salacious scandals, and gruesome murders in a city that has lured most of the richest, most eccentric, and famous residents the world has known. I had one last question for Fogg. Would he agree to tell all about the Ronnie Chasen case? He nodded. Time to set the record straight. As the great quote from a gangster movie goes, "There is a line you cross you don't never come back from." I'm going along for the ride. The whole ride. We hope you enjoy the journey. Barbara Schroeder and Clark Fogg, 2012. And so it begins. The 1910s and 1920s. Beverly Hills. Just the name alone conjures up images of glamour and glitz. But there was a time, long ago in the early 1900s, when this town was but a glimmer in real estate developers' eyes. No mansions, no fancy stores, no tourists. Just lima bean fields and a lonely, dusty train station stop. The only stars to see were the ones twinkling in the night sky. In fact, you could say things didn't get exciting around here until the first traffic accident in 1910. A couple of those newfangled driving machines, Model T Fords, crash over on the newly paved Rodeo Drive. It is the first time a ticket is issued, written up by the first marshal in town, Augustus Nystrom. Even a decade later, in 1919, it's still such a rural area that there isn't even a pokey jail nearby. If someone commits a crime, the new marshal in town, Charlie Blair, takes the bad guy to his house, and Mrs. Blair rustles up a meal and a blanket for an overnight stay. If the bad guy is really rotten, say a bank robber, Blair promptly puts the perpetrator on a Pacific Electric train and ships him off to the downtown Los Angeles County Jail. Fast forward a few more years and things are changing dramatically. No more bean fields. Movie stars and moguls have started moving in. They love this rural and peaceful enclave just west of Hollywood, perfectly situated between the city and the sea, as the brochures boast. Over on Summit Drive, north of Sunset Boulevard, the first movie star mansion pops up. It's home to the world's original celebrity couple, Mary Pickford and Douglas Fairbanks. She is America's sweetheart, the most popular actress of the silent movie era. He is equally famous, a swashbuckling lover who performs his own stunts in movies like Robin Hood, 1922. Gossip columnists, known as Sob Sisters, breathlessly chronicle the couple's scandalous love affair. Both are married to other people. When the lovers finally get their respective divorces and move into their grand manor, they instantly bestow an aura of stardust on the city. The press quickly dubs the place Pickfair, a magnificent home with two separate wings, 5 guest bedrooms, a bowling alley, quarters for 14 live-in servants, and the area's first indoor swimming pool. Pickfair becomes known as the White House of the West, as the couple entertains dignitaries, kings and queens, and luminaries such as physicist Albert Einstein, aviator Charles Lindbergh, and baseball great Babe Ruth. Suddenly, Beverly Hills is on everyone's most wanted list. From 1920 through 1925, the population explodes from 700 residents to 7,500. Mansions spring up everywhere. A rambling bridle path is built, and the city gets its first movie house in 1925, the East Indian-themed Beverly Theater. By the end of the 1920s, the population more than doubles to 17,000. The town's first honorary mayor is announced in 1927, Will Rogers. The cowboy humorist catapults Beverly Hills and its fabulous image onto the national stage. Rogers is the most widely read newspaper columnist of his time, and his dateline reads Beverly Hills. Also in 1927, Marshal Charlie Blair gets a new title. He's now the first official chief of police of Beverly Hills. Blair is a great leader, initiating policies, like fingerprinting all solicitors and salesmen coming into town, that help launch the city's reputation as one of America's safest places to live. His officers are the first in the nation to train at pistol ranges, so they become expert marksmen. Around the city, frisbee-sized red and green lights appear on top of tall structures, water towers, utility poles, and even mansions. It's a crime-fighting system. If the red lights are turned on, street patrol officers rush to the nearest call box to check in with headquarters. If the green lights start to glow, detectives respond immediately. Red and green lights both flashing? Emergency! Calling all cops! Prohibition presents one of the first challenges for the department. It's hard to stop the flow of illegal liquor in a town like this, a town where people have enough money to buy anything, and their homes come complete with secret panels to hide the stuff. Secret doors around town often lead to clandestine custom speakeasies. But police quickly shut down several shady and ingenious operations, like the one where a bold bootlegger fakes a funeral, using a hearse and a procession of cars to deliver bottles of illegal hooch. Sadly, it is also liquor that causes the first tragedy for the police force. On April 9, 1925, 31-year-old motorcycle officer Jesse Farr is driving over a Pacific Electric Railroad crossing on Wilshire Boulevard when a wrong-way driver in a Cadillac smashes into the officer's motorcycle and flees the scene. Bystanders pull the officer from the wreckage. One of his legs has been severed. Farr dies in the hospital the next day, about the same time fellow officers are arresting the driver of the car, who admits he was very drunk and speeding at about 50 miles per hour. Shortly after this incident, the police department deals with the death of another 31-year-old, 1920s actor and sex symbol Rudolph Valentino. The Latin lover dies suddenly in New York due to complications from abdominal surgery. After a memorial service there, the body of the celluloid aphrodisiac is brought via train cross-country to Beverly Hills for a second funeral at the Church of the Good Shepherd on Santa Monica Boulevard at Rodeo Drive. Valentino had come home, but as for most stars of the day, home was a loose term. He'd only lived in his beloved Falcon Lair Beverly Hills estate for about a year before his death. Grieving, weeping fans surround the cathedral, mourners overflowing into the streets, as police arrive for their first crowd control assignment, a sure sign that life and police work in this town will never be simple again. 1912. The Beverly Hills Hotel. Trouble at the Pink Palace. Investor Burton Green was in trouble. Green and his business partners had just made a really bad call. They had hoped to find oil under the bean fields in Beverly Hills. After all, there was plenty of black gold in nearby Los Angeles. But instead of oil, all the wannabe wildcatters dug up was water. The year was 1906. Time for a new plan. Sell the land as lots for exclusive homes. They chose the name Beverly Hills after reading an article about President Taft vacationing in Beverly Farms, Massachusetts, and dressed up the area with lush, grassy parks and magnificent palm trees. Only one problem. Sales were slow. The average price of $500 per parcel was a few hundred more than most lots in Los Angeles. The company needed a draw, some sort of magnet to get the attention of wealthy homebuyers. So Green decided to build a big, a really big, hotel and paint it pink. Green hired the best manager in the business, Margaret Anderson, a widow, to run the new hotel. She was the pioneering manager who turned the Hollywood Hotel in Los Angeles into a class act. Anderson performed the same magic at the Beverly Hills Hotel when it opened in May of 1912, creating a tourist destination as well as a community gathering spot for dances, parties, church services, and even movie screenings. At last, a buying and building boom began, and a village was born. On January 23, 1914, Beverly Hills became a real city, incorporation papers and all. Population, 550. Unfortunately, along with attracting the rich and famous, the hotel attracted troublemakers, too. The first time law enforcement was called to the hotel, the complaint was noisy guests playing a too lively game of poker. Marshal Greenwood arrived to conduct a thorough investigation. He determined that no laws had been broken and promptly sat down to play cards and have a few drinks. He lost his job shortly after, accused of being stewed up, drunk, on duty, and laying down under a palm tree to recover, according to police reports. A far more serious crime occurred years later when some unwelcome guests arrived at the hotel on March 31, 1926, around 3 a.m. Two young men in their 20s, dressed in dark suits, tweed overcoats, and stylish caps, quietly entered the lobby. They approached the night manager, Charlie Fitz. Suddenly, there was a flash of metal as one of the bad guys pulled out a gun and commanded Fitz to open the safe. Charlie struggled to make the dial do its job when suddenly, whack! One of the punks slugged him, knocking him to the floor. The other brute yanked him back up to his knees. This time, despite a case of the shakes, Charlie opened the safe and out poured treasure. Sparkling jewels and wads of cash, stashed there by safety-conscious hotel guests and worth $10,000. The thugs grabbed the loot and made a quick getaway. Newspaper headlines noted, "Police have slender clues," C-L-E-W, that's how they spelled clue back then. But the brutes didn't get away with the dastardly deed. A few months later, the young men were caught robbing yet another hotel. Police used fingerprint technology for the first time in Beverly Hills to catch the thieves, lifting prints from Charlie's safe and putting the youthful bandits behind bars. 1918, the first sensational divorce. Scorned wife's judo justice. They call it crazy time, that period couples go through during a divorce. Smart v. Smart was an epic custody battle that culminated in a showdown involving guns, judo experts, and a bizarre hostage, a house. When the Smart marriage crumbled in the couple's Canadian homeland, Howard Smart, an accountant, was despondent. Not only would his temperamental wife, Marie, abandon the family and disappear for long periods of time, but when she was at home, she spoke constantly of how she intended to get her hands on some of the millions belonging to her sister-in-law, who was married to one of the richest men in Canada. After a series of court battles and a highly unusual ruling, the father was awarded custody of the couple's 7-year-old daughter and 10-year-old son. Howard Smart moved his fractured little family into a guest house at his sister's new estate in Beverly Hills. He was hoping to raise his children in peace now that his wife had disappeared again. But his tranquility was shattered one chilly November night in 1918 when, during the middle of dinner, Marie Smart reappeared, bursting through the door with two judo experts at her side. She'd come to take her kids. Smart leapt into action, took out his .45 automatic, fired several shots into the air, grabbed the children, and quickly whisked them up to the main house where they all spent the night. His wife refused to leave the guest house. She settled in for the night with her two sidekicks as bodyguards. The house was her hostage until morning, when she was arrested for disturbing the peace. Marie Smart's trial was the talk of Beverly Hills. Newspaper reports detailed how the jury and audience, made up of men and women from the less luxuriant walks of life, were riveted by the testimony. The case was heard with just 11 jurors after one was excused by the judge, owing to urgent housework. When Smart took the stand, she testified that her rich sister-in-law had verbally poisoned her children against her, telling them their mom was crazy. She described how her kids wouldn't hug or kiss her anymore and began to cry. The jury was moved to tears as well and deliberated just 3 minutes before coming back with an acquittal. The Smarts worked things out between themselves eventually. Howard Smart took over primary care of the children, but not before another unusual legal twist. The judo duo, who were never arrested, decided to charge him with attempted murder. Smart hired the most famous criminal attorney at the time, Earl Rogers, to represent him in court. "A man's home is his castle," Rogers passionately proclaimed, explaining Smart wasn't aiming to kill, rather just to frighten intruders away to protect his children. Thanks to Rogers's eloquent arguments, the lawsuit was dismissed. It was a groundbreaking case, one that would go on to be cited in future incidents involving capital crimes and homeowners. Earl Rogers was an impressive legal superstar of the times, losing only 3 of 77 murder trials. A popular 1960s television program, called Perry Mason, was based on his career. Rogers's daughter, Adela, was often his sidekick in court. She went on to become famous in her own right as Adela Rogers St. John's, one of the era's best girl reporters. In later years, after the children were grown, Howard Smart became the first volunteer deputy probation officer for the courts in Beverly Hills, saying he wanted to give back to the city where he had been treated so fairly and had finally been able to raise his children in peace. 1920. The Beverly Hills Speedway Tragedy. Chevrolet Air Dies. Beverly Hills ushered in the Roaring Twenties with the sound of race cars. A group of fun-loving actors and investors, known as the Beverly Hills Speedway Syndicate, raised some $500,000 to build a spectacular speedway and stadium that seated over 70,000 people. The Toothpick Track, it was made of wooden planks, was 1.25 miles long with a 35-degree bank. Second only in stature to the venerable Indianapolis Speedway, the track was an instant sensation, and its Indy 500-style races were broadcast nationwide, adding to the city's newly glamorous appeal. The winning speed on opening day registered an eye-popping 103.2 miles per hour. Californians thrilled when daring riders pace fastest track in the world with terrific speed, touted the headlines. But tragedy struck on Thanksgiving Day of 1920, the last race of the inaugural season. Police were called to the scene after a terrible accident occurred involving Gaston Chevrolet, the younger brother of the founder of the Chevrolet Car Company. Investigators pieced together the story of what happened from eyewitnesses. Gaston and another driver appeared to be fighting to make up the half-dozen laps they were behind. Suddenly, three cars bunched up on a turn. Chevrolet tried to pass, but his heavy racing car struck and sideswiped a Duesenberg, sending autos careening out of control and over the top of the track. The impact tore out about 20 feet of fence. The vehicles rolled down an incline, and Chevrolet's car landed on top of another, pinning inside the driver and his ride-along mechanic. When the dust cleared, it was a heartbreaking sight. Three men, including Chevrolet, were dead. One person, Chevrolet's mechanic, walked away from the smash-up, but suffered serious injuries. Chevrolet, an up-and-coming driver who won the Indy 500 earlier in the year, was just 28 years old when he died. Friends said he'd been sick for several days and almost bowed out of the race, deciding at the last minute to get into his car. His body was flown back for burial in Indianapolis, where he lived. The next race, a few weeks later, began with a moment of silence as the engines then roared to life. The track stayed open for only 4 years. It was raised because property values had skyrocketed, and land-hungry business developers made an offer the city couldn't refuse. And with that, the brief era of NASCAR 90210 became history. 1922. The Secret Attic Lover. Crazy Love Triangle. One of the first grocery stores in Beverly Hills was owned by a very private widow who lived in near seclusion above the store, but Beverly Hills police knew exactly who she was and were keeping an eye on her. Dolly Oesterreich, the woman behind the most fantastic murder story of the times, involving a secret teenage sex slave she had stashed in her attic for more than a decade while her husband was totally unaware. The salacious saga began in Milwaukee. Dolly, whose real first name was Valburga, was married to Fred, a wealthy apron manufacturer. She liked his money, but found him boring. So when this 26-year-old housewife needed her sewing machine fixed, she used the opportunity to get her insatiable sex drive fixed, too, by Otto Sanhuber, the 17-year-old sewing machine repairman her husband sent over from the factory. Suddenly, Dolly's machine needed a lot of repairs. The crazed lovers wanted more together time, so they came up with a novel plan for a love nest. Otto moved into the couple's 10-by-28-foot attic, and during the day, while husband Fred was at work, the couple carried on sexual trysts in between cooking and cleaning house together. Then, at night, before Fred would come home, Otto retreated to the tiny rooftop room where he wrote lusty romance stories and murder mysteries by candlelight, articles he occasionally sold to magazines. For 10 years, in 5 different homes, the last one in Los Angeles, Otto lived secretly tucked away in the attics. On August 22, 1922, Otto heard a violent argument erupt down below. Fred was threatening Dolly. Fearing for his lady love's safety, the attic boy blew his cover and raced downstairs with a pistol. Husband Fred recognized Otto and was shell-shocked. The two men struggled and Otto fired, shooting his former boss twice in the heart, once in the back of the head. Fred was dead. The secret lovers quickly concocted an alibi. Dolly would tell police that burglars killed her husband. They swore on their undying love they would never tell anyone what had really happened. Otto locked Dolly in a closet and ran to his attic haunt to hide. The police showed up, were suspicious, but didn't have any evidence to file charges. It would be almost a year later before some of the truth came out. Dolly had amassed 2 more male friends by then, with Otto still living in the attic. The first new friend, Roy Klum, turned her into the cops after she broke off their relationship. He went straight to police and told them he'd thrown a gun into the La Brea tar pits for Dolly, and he realized now it was probably the murder weapon that she may have used to kill her husband. Dolly was arrested, and on her first night in jail, she made an odd request to her other friend, her estate attorney, Howard Shapiro. Please go to her house, tap on the attic door, and tell the man inside it's okay to come out. Shapiro obliged and was shocked to see someone pop out. Otto and Shapiro began talking, and once Otto learned Dolly was in jail, he spilled the beans.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.